Oh, praise the Lord. Aren't you grateful he walked out? Let's stand to our feet. Let's worship him together. Sing.
God sent his son. They call him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior.
Amen. That was awesome. Amen. Yes, amen. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. He is risen indeed. You know, I was just listening to you all singing, our wonderful choir and musicians and orchestra and everything. And it makes me think about one day we get to heaven, what it's going to be like to rejoice in the presence of the Lord because he is risen. What a glorious day that's going to be. I want to welcome all of you. Appreciate you being here. Welcome those watching by TV and online. We're so glad you're here. And all our guests this morning, we're glad that you're here. And I want to ask you to do something special. In your bulletin this morning, there's a QR code on the second page there. It says, if you're a first-time guest, or a second-time guest, or a first-time guest and a long-time guest, we want you to do this for us, okay? Take your phone and scan that. You don't have to do it right now. You do it when you get home. Put your camera to that link there on the QR code, and it will pop up a little link on your phone, and you can touch that, and we'll go to a form that you can fill out, and we can get your information. Now, I want you to know, we'd love to have your information because we want to thank you for being with us. We will not sell it to anybody on the Internet. We not give it away so that your car warranty won't be expired, okay? We're glad you're here this morning. What a great day to be in the Lord's house. We started early at Jardigan Cemetery at 7 a.m. What a glorious time that was. And I've already heard from Harold Park, the ones out there, what a great time it was. But we want to worship the Lord King, the risen Savior. Amen. Let's go to him in prayer this morning. Father, we thank you for this day. This is the day you have made for us to worship in, because that day when you died on an old rugged cross for our sin, and Lord, 3 days later you arose, victorious forevermore over death, hell, and the grave, and the evil one who tries to rule and reign in our world. Pray that you'd speak to all of our hearts this morning. Pray for our brother Dean as he comes in a few minutes to proclaim your truth. Lord, you just anoint him from on high. You just fill him with your spirit. Lord, give him the clarity of thought and mind and speech and word to declare your truth. And Lord, I pray you'd give us hearts and minds to receive your truth. Lord, I pray that you'd save souls, change lives for your glory this morning. For it's in Christ's name I ask you, and amen.
Yeah. Oh, praise the Lord this morning. Because he walked out of the grave, we will too. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. Let's sing.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree.
Think about it.
His body. They laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed with heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone.
Let's praise him this morning. Sing. Worthy. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for an empty grave this morning. Thank you, Lord, that you loved us so much that you sent your Son, that your Son died on an old rugged cross for our sins. But Father, he didn't stay there. Father, thank you for an empty tomb this morning. We celebrate that this morning. Lord, we lift you up in this place. We give you honor and glory in Jesus' name and amen. Thank you. You may be seated. He's worthy this morning. Would you remain standing or stand? Would you sing this little chorus with me? He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. How many of you know that little chorus? I think you do. Let's sing it. He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen. Risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I just want to hear just your voices sing that. Can we do that? That's beautiful. He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee. Can you praise Him one more time this morning, church? God bless you.
Well, amen, church family. Let me just say one quick word. Whatever Washington, D.C. may call today, it is Easter Sunday all day long. And He has risen. Amen. Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, praise the Lord. It's so good to see you on this beautiful, beautiful day. Thank you, choir and orchestra. Man, oh man, they worked so hard to be able to lead us in worship today. Thank you, Preston. What a great, great celebration in worship and song. I'm so excited about the message today, and I want to get right into it. Matthew chapter 28 will be our text today, beginning with verse 1, page 861 in your pew Bible, in case you need a copy of God's Word. Our resurrection series has been Behold Jesus. The word behold is used 1,298 times in the Bible. In the Old Testament, it is the Hebrew word hine. In the New Testament, it is the Greek word adu, as in Joseph adu go Vols. In both testaments, in both languages, the word behold means pay attention. Look at this. There's something that you need to stop and see. And so we're going to see that all over our scripture today. We have been looking at that word behold. Behold as the Lamb of God rides into the city gates of Jerusalem. A couple of weeks ago, we call it Palm Sunday. Behold, fulfilling Zechariah 9, captured in John chapter 12. Behold the man, as Pilate said. Behold the man, the branch, the crucified Savior, who would die on an old rugged cross that we might have everlasting life. But today, the behold of the triumph over sin, death, hell, and the grave in a message that I have entitled, Behold the Risen King. Now, here's what I want to do for our scripture reading this morning. I want to walk us through this text, and I first want to point out the four times in these verses, Matthew 28, 1 through 15, that this word behold is used. I want you to get it in your notes, circle it in your Bible. I want you to see where it's used in Scripture. First of all, it is used in connection with an earthquake. Look at verse 1. Now, after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, pay attention, there was a great earthquake. Look at the second behold, through an angel. Verse 2 goes on to say these words. For an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and they became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the women, Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen just as he said. I'm reminded of the little Easter play that the kids were doing in a church. And little five-year-old Billy had one line that he had to remember. He is not here, he is risen. And so he got to his line. The church was packed full of parents, grandparents. He got to his line and he froze, Brother Steve. Couldn't think of it at all. And the director eased up there and whispered in his ear, "Billy, here's your line." Billy got big eyes. He grabbed the microphone out of her hand and he said, "He is not here. He is in prison." That's not exactly what this says. He's not here. He has risen, as he said. Now look at this in verse 6. "Come, see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he's risen from the dead, and indeed is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him." Now here's the second one. "Behold," pay attention, hear what I'm telling you, "I have told you." The third "behold" is used in connection with the risen Jesus. Look at verse 8. "So they went out quickly from the tomb, and with fear and great joy, and ran back to his disciples' words. And they went back to tell his disciples, 'Behold,'" listen, "'Jesus met them saying, Rejoice.' So they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren to go to Galilee where they will see me.'" And then the fourth time that this word "behold" is found is with the Roman soldiers, beginning in verse 11. What was the response to all of this? "Now while they," the women, "were going, behold," pay attention, "some of the guard came into the city and reported to the chief priests all the things that had happened. When they assembled with the elders and consulted together, they gave a large sum of money to the soldiers, saying, 'Tell them, his disciples came at night and stole him away while we slept. And if this comes to the governor's ears, we will appease him and make you secure.' So they took the money and did as they were instructed. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day." Is there any word from the Lord for us on this Easter Sunday in these four "beholds" that are in this passage of Scripture? I think so. I want you to see them, and I'm praying that God will speak to our hearts today in a fresh and mighty way. First of all, notice, go back to that first "behold." The "behold," I call it the "behold" of God's voice through an earthquake. God announced the resurrection of his son through an earthquake. But go back one chapter and you will find that an earthquake also happened when Jesus died on the cross. Look back one chapter at Matthew chapter 27, verse 50. Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Then behold, pay attention, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth quaked and the rocks were split. Verse 54, now listen to this good news. "So when the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the" what, church? When they saw the earthquake. When they saw the earthquake and the things that had happened, they feared greatly, saying, "Truly, this was the Son of God." God used an earthquake to speak to a pagan Roman Gentile soldier and to get him convinced that this was indeed the Son of God. The voice of God through an earthquake. What do we know about earthquakes in the Bible? Well, there are at least four things that I found. We know, first of all, that God used earthquakes to voice his power. There was an earthquake on day 3 of creation where the land was separated from the water masses. Job declared, Job 9:6, "He shakes the earth from its place and makes its pillars tremble." There was an earthquake at Mount Sinai in Exodus 19 when Moses was given the 10 commandments. God uses earthquakes to voice his power. Here's a second thing. God also used earthquakes as a word of warning. Before the worldwide flood in Noah's day, the Bible says that the deep split apart and opened up the fountains of the deep and caused the flood to cover the entire world. In the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, there was an earthquake. Amos warned in Amos 1:1, "A great earthquake is coming because of your sin, and God is going to use it to speak to you and judge you." And sure enough, 2 years later, church, probably the greatest recorded earthquake in all the Bible, many who have studied it said it was probably somewhere between an 8 and an 8.2 earthquake hit this region during the days of King Uzziah and brought great, great destruction and death as a result of the people's sin. God used earthquakes to voice his power. God used them as a word of warning. God will use increased earthquakes to beckon us, to tell us that we're in the last days as well. Jesus said this clearly. One of the signs that is near the coming, his coming again, was going to be increasing frequency and intensity of earthquakes. An earthquake, by the way, will also take place when he comes again. According to Zechariah, when he splits the Mount of Olives open, and it's going to be an earthquake of major proportions, Zechariah said in the very next verse when he prophesied about it, you will flee as you fled from the earthquake in the days of King Uzziah. That's the one Amos spoke of, the king of Judah. God used earthquakes to voice his power. He used earthquakes as a word of warning to his people. He used earthquakes as a signal, or will use them as a signal of the last days. But here's the fourth thing we know about earthquakes, and this is mighty neat. God also used earthquakes to share the gospel. Remember the earthquake that came during Paul and Silas's imprisonment in Philippi? And as a result, the Philippian jailer and his whole house came to know the Lord. Now listen to me carefully this morning. I'm not praying for a catastrophic earthquake to come on America. It's possible with the fault lines that we have across our country. That's very, very possible. And it's possible that God would somehow use that to voice his power and to voice a message for us. But here's what I am praying today. I'm praying for a spiritual earthquake to take place in your life. I'm praying that God would shake the foundations of your heart and your soul. If you're here today and you do not believe in this risen Jesus, I'm praying that you will come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that you will declare the same thing the centurion declared, truly, this was the Son of God. Truly, he is the Son of God. Truly, he is the Son of God, and I have believed on his name. The behold of God's voice through an earthquake. Oh, but let's look at the second one this morning, church. Look at the behold of removed barriers. God used an angel to remove all kinds of barriers so the folks could see Jesus. Now, it wasn't the angel of the Lord. It was an angel of the Lord. But look at his assignment. Look what the Bible says was his assignment. Six things. I'm going to give these to you really quickly. Six things that this angel removed so that we could see the risen Jesus. The first two barriers were removed out of the way of the women, so that they could get to the tomb and see that it was empty. First of all, he removed the stone in verse 2. Not so Jesus could get out, but so they could look in, because Jesus was already out. Look at the second thing. He removed the soldiers in verses 3 and 4. They saw this angel and they all fainted like dead men. And the threat of the soldiers for the women to go to the tomb was no longer there. Look at the third thing. He removed the women's skepticism. Jesus is not here, he's risen. Come and see the place where the Lord lay, the angel said. Then he removed, number 4, their sorrow. They went out quickly with godly fear and with great joy. Talking about a change of heart, a change of attitude. Then number 5, he removed their silence. Verse 8, they ran to bring the disciples word that Jesus was alive. And then number 6, I love this one. He also removed them from the sepulcher. Now do your best to spell that. That's the tomb. He removed them from the graveyard so they could see the risen Jesus. Listen, sometimes God's got to get us out of the graveyard because we think the graveyard's the end. We got to get out of the graveyard where we can see that the victory is in the Lord Jesus Christ. I had a great honor this past Friday. I was asked to preach at the big community-wide Good Friday service in Maryville. And we had a huge crowd there under a huge tent. Folks, let me tell you, it was something awesome. They bussed over 200 teenagers in there that had just carried a huge wooden cross all the way across Blount County. And they came in under the tent and posted that cross, and all of those teenagers knelt at the foot of that cross. It was incredible. And I had the privilege of getting up and preaching after that. Brother Preston led the music. He sang the song right before I preached that service. But Pam and I went a little early because my mom and dad are buried at Grandview Cemetery in Maryville. That's where Pam and I are going to be buried someday. We have a mausoleum there. I told Pam, if you'll marry me, I'll get you a condo in the Smokies. It's right there, right there on the way to Townsend. So we went by to look at Mom and Dad's grave. I hadn't been there in a couple of years. And when I walked away and we got back in the car, I felt the same thing then that I did in 2006. They aren't here. The Lord got me out of the graveyard so I could see the victory in the Lord Jesus Christ. That He defeated sin, death, hell, and the grave. So that I don't have to look at that graveyard and say, they're here, they're in the ground, they're, this is the end. I'll never see my mom or my dad or my loved one ever again. Oh, I'm telling you, the victory that we have in the Lord Jesus. And this angel took them out of the graveyard so they could see the Lord Jesus Christ. Now listen to me. Here's what I've been praying. God wants to remove every obstacle and every barrier that is keeping you from Jesus. We no longer have an angel that needs to do that because we now have the Holy Spirit. And I've been praying that the Holy Spirit would work in this room today and move in hearts here today. I've been praying for God to remove for some of you the barrier of logic. Well, I just don't believe the Bible. I just don't know if it's true. I think it's all written by men. I'm praying that the Holy Spirit would remove that so you can see the risen Jesus here today. I'm praying that He would remove the barrier of emotions. Some of us are so hurt, we're so angry, we're so discouraged, we're so disappointed. Something's happened in our lives, maybe we're even angry at God, and we can't see or sense the presence of the Lord. Oh Lord, remove that barrier from whoever my brother or sister is that's hurting on the inside, that's got pain on the inside. Remove that barrier so that they can see the living hope of the Lord Jesus Christ. For some of us, it's the barrier of behavior. I just don't want to change my life. I don't want to change my lifestyle. I'm content to be away from God. I'm content to do my own thing. Lord, would You remove that barrier of behavior and help people to know that the greatest life you can ever live is a life lived for the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm praying that God would remove the barrier of culture. Well, I just didn't grow up a Baptist. I didn't grow up a Christian. I'm a Hindu. I'm a Buddhist. I'm Jewish. I'm this. I'm that. As a matter of fact, listen, I think one of the greatest barriers that has to be removed for some people to see the real Jesus is the cultural Christianity barrier. While we've just been Christians all of our lives, it's the thing Granny taught us to do, go to church. There's really no worship. There's really no walk with the Lord. Listen, I'm praying that God would remove that barrier in your heart and your mind so that you can see the real Jesus and get fired up for the real Jesus and walk with Him. But the greatest barrier that many are facing today is the spiritual barrier. We do not understand how Satan wants to keep us from the gospel. And he is doing everything he can to keep you away from the gospel. Listen what Paul said, 2 Corinthians 4, if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age is blinded, who do not believe lest the light of the gospel, the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. Oh God, remove that spiritual blindness and that spiritual barrier that somebody here today might see what we've seen, the living Lord Jesus Christ. Satan wants to keep you blind to the gospel. But listen, here's what I'm praying. Here's the third behold. Look at it. This is what I'm praying today. And this will happen in your life if you'll give your life to Jesus. The behold of encountering Jesus, the risen Savior. God wants you to meet Him today. He doesn't want you to put it off. He wants you to come to Jesus Christ today. And here's the message to you. Look at verse 9. As they went to tell His disciples, behold, Jesus met them saying, rejoice. So they came and held Him by the feet and worshiped Him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren to go to Galilee, and there they will see me. The God of heaven wants you to leave here today rejoicing because you've met Him. You know that your sins, everything about Jesus is joy. He wants you to leave here rejoicing today. He wants you to be filled with an inexpressible, glorious joy. If you want joy, real joy, wonderful joy, let Jesus come into your heart. They left there rejoicing. Look what else. They also left there worshiping. They held Him by the feet. Oh, Lord, it's You. We can't let You go. It's You, and we worship You. You know what worship is? It's the thing you cling to the most. And these ladies were clinging to Jesus. They were worshiping Him. Matthew, we don't want to be like the folks of Matthew 15 that Jesus talked about, the people who honor Him with their lips, but their heart is far from Him, and in vain they worship Him. When you truly encounter the Lord Jesus Christ, you can't help but worship Him. I know that's expressed in different ways, but man, oh man, there's something so real about knowing the living Jesus. These ladies left there rejoicing. They left there worshiping. They also, look at the third thing, they left set free from their fear. What did Jesus say to them? Don't be afraid. Jesus is your answer for the fear in your life, the worry in your life, the anxiety in your life. Some of us are filled with it. What's going to happen? We don't know what the future is going to hold. And Jesus says to us, don't be afraid. Don't sweat it. Because if you'll just trust in Me, everything will be okay. His message to you and I today is cast all your care upon Him because He cares for you. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. Oh, but there's also one more thing that happened to these ladies. And that is they left there going and telling. I love this. Telling everybody about Jesus. He's alive. Next week, we're going to have a gospel training seminar here at our church. We got a man coming in that's going to train us to say, ask one question. Can I ask you a question? And then from there, jump into a gospel conversation. There are so many of us that have never shared Jesus with another person. We need to know how to share the living Jesus with our lost friends and neighbors. We're going to learn more about that next week. One of our Focus 24 events on evangelism training. Listen, here's what I'm saying to you today. If you encounter the living Jesus, you are going to leave here worshiping. You're going to leave here rejoicing. You're going to leave here unafraid. And you're going to go out of these doors and you're going to say, I want to tell my friends, my buddies, my neighbors, I want to tell everybody about the Lord Jesus. Behold, pay attention to this, Jesus said. Look what I can do in your life. If you'll just surrender your life to Me, if you'll listen to Me and turn to Me and allow the barriers to be removed, I will change your life and I will give you victory and abundance. I thought about this. Some of you have tried everything else. You've tried everything else. What about giving Jesus not just a try, but a trust? Trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and see what He can do to change your life. There's one more behold that I think we have to look at today because it's so prevalent in our world today. And I call it the behold of Satan's opposition, deception and lies. There's so much of that going on in our world. Listen, from the very beginning in the garden, Satan has opposed God. Do you remember the first words that he ever uttered to Eve? Has God really said that? doubting his word, casting doubt. And it's the same thing that happened with the resurrection. I want you to look at the screen because I want you to get this in your mind and your heart. It should come as no surprise to us that just after the greatest event in human history, the resurrection of Christ from the grave, Satan, the father of lies, would invent a lie to keep people from believing and being saved. The Roman soldiers who were guarding the tomb were basically bribed. They were given money. Change the story. We can't let this story that Jesus rose from the grave get out. We've got to change the story, change the narrative, cause people to think differently and believe a lie. Tell them that while you were asleep, that the disciples came and stole the body. We've talked about that before. Jesus said about these Jewish religious leaders, listen to what he said in chapter 8, verse 44. You are of the father, your father, the devil, and you want the desires of your father. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in truth because there is no truth in him. Whenever he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own nature, for he is a liar and the father of lies. What did they do? Verse 15, they set in motion Satan's deception. They set in motion Satan's lie that was perpetrated around the entire community. They took the money and did as they were instructed. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day. Oh, let me just say this again. Do you know how much Satan wants to keep you from believing this story? Do you know how much he wants to keep you in darkness and in bondage? Do you know that he is not wanting you to believe? He's wanting you to go out the same way that you came in. He's wanting you to come out without the living Jesus in your heart. Just come in. It's Easter. I had to go because my family told me to go. But I'm telling you, God wants to do a new work in your life. God wants to do a fresh work in your life. Satan wants you to be lost, stay lost, and die lost someday. But here's what Jesus said. Jesus said, I've come to save you. I've come to seek and to save those who are lost. John said it this way, the Son of God appeared to destroy the works of the devil. Hebrews 2:14, Christ took on human nature that through death he might destroy him who has the power of death, that is the devil. The decisive blow was struck at Calvary's cross and then sealed at the garden tomb. When Jesus came up from the grave, he wants you to be saved today. Listen to me, every barrier removed. You say, well, I would come to Jesus today, Pastor, and I feel this longing in my heart to give my life to Jesus, but this is not the church that I usually go to. Maybe I'll wait till I get to my home church. The crowd's too big today, so I'm not going to give my life to Jesus today. All kinds of barriers, all kinds of obstacles. Who is behind that, folks? The enemy. He's lying to you. He wants to keep you from salvation. He wants to keep you from Jesus. He wants to keep you from abundant life. But I'm declaring to you today on this Easter Sunday that today is the day of salvation. Listen, I thought about one more behold in the Bible, and it's found in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. And Jesus is standing outside of a door, and in this case, it's the door of the church at Laodicea. But it could also be an image of him standing here today outside of your heart. And the Bible says this, Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Will you let me come in? Will you open the door of your heart and let me come in? And Jesus said, we'll have sweet fellowship together. Behold, I'm standing right now at your heart's door. Pay attention. That's what he was saying. Pay attention. This may be our last opportunity to come to Jesus and believe in Jesus Christ as our Savior and our Lord. I shared on Friday night about a young man, 26 years old, one of my former churches, and this young man took his own life. It was a very sad thing. His mom, who was a faithful member of our church, asked me if I would preach his funeral, and I said yes. I got there a little early, and she was there. She said, Pastor, she took a piece of paper out of her Bible, and she gave it to me. She said, I want you to have a copy of this. It was the note that that young man left, his suicide note, and it was way too long and personal to share a whole lot, but there was one thing that stood out. He said, because of the choices that I've made, I've lost all hope. Listen, Jesus doesn't want you to go out of here without hope. And that hope is in Him. Give Him your heart and your life here today. What will you do with the risen Lord Jesus Christ?